Good afternoon. So first and foremost, I want to thank Bio-Rad for the kind invitation. I'm a little bit upset because I was put in the postprandial spot. So I have two tasks. One, to keep you awake, and one, to avoid make you guilt of all the carb, gluten-loaded stuff for those that they ate that, because I know that some of you guys did not, because they are proudly part of the family of the celiacs. As a matter of background, I'm a pediatric gastroenterologist by training, therefore I unfortunately wear a lot of hats. I am the director of a couple centers, the mucosal biology research centers, and for that I do a lot of research and development, particularly in diagnostics. I also directed this Center for Seeded Research that, among the other things, is extremely heavily loaded with clinical care, so I see a lot of patients, and therefore I am one of your customers, because when I have to make a diagnosis, I have to send stuff to you guys. What I try to do in this hour and a half, without bothering you too much and putting you asleep, is to use seeded disease really a paradigm. A paradigm that will tell us some shift of understanding about immunity, some that already saw the streamline of clinical applicability, including diagnostics, some that are in the making. And because it's quite unique as a paradigm of autoimmunity, I have the bias to believe that in looking at celiac disease and what's going on there, probably we will see what's going to happen, the marker of autoimmunity in general, particularly the way that we approach diagnostic treatment of autoimmunity in the foreseen future. And this will have, of course, scientific implication, business implication, how you run the lab and how you make this kind of use of this knowledge, particularly because we have lab managers, technicians, and lab directors here. I have a quite ambitious schedule here. I'm going to use just a few moments for the definition of celiac disease and some new information about pathogenesis, because from pathogenesis you will see the outcome in terms of diagnostic algorithm that will change, why this is a one-of-a-kind model of autoimmunity that is teaching us so much about other autoimmune diseases. You heard from Mike how sometimes it's vague in terms of biomarkers, the lack of specificity, the use and abuse, and so on and so forth. And so we will revisit some of these concepts. What is the current and what is the immediate future diagnostic tools that we have available? What is the epidemiology of celiac disease? And here we have major breakthrough as well. You heard that this is one of the most frequent autoimmune diseases in the United States. Take the United States out, let's put worldwide. And most importantly for this audience, what is in the pipeline? And what is coming in the future in terms of diagnostics? And I will have the ambition to talk a little bit about business models. Because I see the current models, me user as a physician, you provider as a lab, that will be obsolete. The sooner we understand that, the more ahead of the game you guys will be, because this complete dichotomy of who provide the service for diagnostic and who is going to make use of it, it will not be the way that we do medicine in the future. The more we move towards, personalized medicine, because the current way to do healthcare is not sustainable, the more this is going to be the theme of the future, in which the diagnostic lab, the drug development, and the physician are aspect of the same paradigm. I add a couple of slides as a background just to give a more a clear ideas in terms of what are the objectives. Again, you will see that we move from the typical vision of celiac disease, gluten, high environment, plus genes, celiac disease, to a much more complicated and yet interesting story that is leading to better understanding of the intimate mechanism of autoimmunity and how this all is related. Now, when I start to talk about autoimmunity, and forgive me, I'm a gastroenterologist, so I'm a little bit biased here. The battlefield of all this, as you will see, most likely is the gut. And if I have to make a definition of the gut, I really have a hard time because it's such a complex and yet fascinating organ. Of all the definitions out there, the best that fits what I think is the current understanding of the intestine as a battlefield is the definition that I got from one of my students, a second grader. Where is my, oh, here we go. That gave this definition of the intestine. Let's skip this because inflammation here. Forget about the spelling, okay? The intestine is a long tube with a clean open on the top and a dirty open at the bottom. I challenge each and every of you guys to give me a better definition. And she made this clean on the top and dirty on the bottom. I asked her about this fish. And I said, dear, what is this? That will be the noise that my dad typically make from the dirty hand. And I met the man. Now, we physicians, we have an Holy Father, the ones that really started our profession, that was Hippocrates. Many centuries ago, this fellow already understood the basic of what I'm trying to communicate to you guys today. All disease begins in the gut. Everything that we have to deal with in terms of inflammation begins there. Now, personally, I gave an updated version of the story. This is my definition. The gut is not like Las Vegas. What happened in the gut does not stay in the gut. I made this statement last year. I know this is laughable, but trust me, if you follow me a little bit, I will make the point there is no autoimmune disease that does not see the gut as the battlefield. And the reason why I'm saying this is because it is undisputable that the environment is a key element of the recipe for autoimmunity. And environment means known self-antigens, i.e. molecules that need to come in and interface with the immune system that is skewed because of genetically make up to lead to autoimmunity. The major port of entry, and there is no question about that, of these environmental triggers of autoimmunity is the gut. So the gut is really the battlefield where friends and foes needs to be distinguished day in and day out. The second largest interface, the lung, does not have this problem. Everything that is in the lung, in terms of a quote-unquote molecule, is an enemy and needs to be get rid of. And the lung immune system is built that way. But the gut does not have that luxury. Imagine if everything that comes through that tube is considered and treated as an enemy. Whatever you ate right now would be a reason of increasing a fight and a battle. So we will all die of starvation, and we're not going to sit here to listen to this murder for the next 90 minutes, because it would not be life if indeed the gut would not be able to say, you're good, you can stay. You're not good, I need to get rid of you. This is under normal circumstances what the gut does every single freaking day, many, many times. Celiac disease is the paradigm of how a friend, a nutrient, because that's what gliadin and gluten is all about, becomes a foe under very, very special circumstances, okay? The story of celiac disease starts not long ago, and many people, they don't know that. And I believe now we're going back to the regular schedule of there. And they don't know that, but I think there is so much wisdom in medicine when you go back and read history. Because sometimes we forgot what our predecessors already found out, and we come to go in a oblivious of this concept to resurface later on. The guy that for the very first time put on the map the modern definition of celiac disease was known from ancient Greeks. The first description probably was 2,500 years ago. But the modern definition came from this fellow, Samuel Gee, that gave this historical lecture on celiac affection in Saint Barth, in 1890. So we are not talking about long ago. Now, 1890, guys, genetics was a very vague concept. There is no understanding of the immune system in 1890. There was still the philosophical understanding of what was the immune system. So there was some vagueness in the entire business. So the guy come with some pillars that turns to be the truth of celiac disease in specific and autoimmune in general. And these are pieces that I took from his speech. They are not being changed. First of all, he's telling us it's a chronic, so long-term, that will not go away. And for many years, we thought that you can grow out of celiac disease, but I said chronic indigestion, number one. Number two, he's telling us that no age is spared. Until the 80s, we were under the impression that this was a premise of pediatrics. As a matter of fact, the best experts in the world are still pediatric gastroenterologists. This generation now is fading off. But the concept was, this is a pediatric condition. If you're an adult with celiac disease, it's because you were a pediatric graduated as an adult. But he already knew there was no age spared, even if he admitted that kids were, you know, the most affected one. He also understood at that time, and was a revolutionized concept, that this was a malabsorption syndrome. Now, 1890, you guys did not exist. There was no such a thing as the lab. Diagnostics was hands-on. What was a science that now we don't use terminology of that anymore, semiotic, meaning you make diagnosis by putting your hands on the problem. Now, when you talk about hands-on for a gastroenterologist, I know that we just ate, but I gotta tell you this. You put the hands-on on the material, and you go on a excruciatingly description of the byproduct of the gut. So he goes by saying, look, the shit of these people is loose, not formed, but not watery. So he said, you know, this is not like a real disease due to infection, it's watery, but it's loose. But the thing that he's telling us are more bulky than the food taken would seem to account for. In other words, they eliminate more, it seems like that they eliminate more than they eat, meaning malabsorption syndrome. Okay? This is not a breakthrough of another statement that he makes. So he's telling us that it's a malabsorption syndrome, it's chronic, and it's encountered in any age. And then he moves in to put into the equation a genetic concept. Again, Mendel did not even play with the piece yet here, okay? So he said, I don't know freaking reason to understand what's wrong with these folks. The cause of the disease is obscure. Why these kids, they have this? And I don't know. He said, maybe error in the diet, environmental, can be part of it. But what kind of error? Why in the family of kids that are fed all the same way, one got it and the other one does not? And he starts to question this interplay between the environment, he already had this intuition that was, you know, food that these kids they're eating, and their makeup, how they're made, that now we know being the human genome. He went so far to even propose an intervention. Now, he got a little lost here, but again, put this in perspective. The major treatment is to regulate the food. He knows already, points already about, you know, flour-based food stuff. He said allowance of farinized food must be small, highly starched, blah, 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 and so on and so forth. And he really got lost. Malted food is bad, also rusks or bread, provided it's cut thin and well toasted on both sides. So again, it's laughable what we know now. But you need to put this in perspective. The environmental trigger, the one that made these people sick, was not discovered until the mid 40s early 50s. So 70 years later that this guy gave this talk, but this Dutch pediatrician, Dickey, they made a tremendously important epidemiological observation. You die of celiac disease before that this fellow find out what was wrong. 35-40% mortality rate. And at that time, when we didn't have your help in terms of diagnostic tools, this was the process, the typical process. You got sick as a child. You are brought to your family doctor. They say, you know what? This kid is losing weight, is having chronic diarrhea, and so on and so forth. He or she may have celiac disease. Your family bring the kids to the local hospital. And the hospitalists will see the kids, will confirm the diagnosis, and will tell your parents, okay, leave the kid here, come back in 6 months. Do not show up before the 6 months. If he or she will leave, we'll give you back. And in that 6 months, these kids were fed only and exclusively bananas. Only bananas. And that's the reason that generation is called the banana babies generation. This lady gave a talk at Maryland. Probably she was the first one that was diagnosed with celiac disease in Maryland in 1938. She gave a wonderful talk of her experience, okay? And came to give a talk and told us all the nine yards, and she's living in a retirement place. She's in the mid-70s now, something like that. And this is the nurse that was taking care of her. She also is in the same retirement place. Kind of strange, you know, twists of life. Now, what this guy found out was that while the mortality was so high, during World War II, the mortality went to zero. No kids were dying for celiac disease. And resurfaced again at the rate before the war, soon after that the war was over. And what was his major intuition was that during the war, because of scarcity of wheat, flour was made with potato starch. And then when wheat was reintroduced after the war, celiac disease came back. That's how we learned that gluten is the culprit. 1951, not 1751, 1951, the history is recent. Now, fast forward nowadays. What we know about celiac disease? Of course, it's an autoimmune disease, otherwise I would not be here today, okay? But it's one of a kind that's leading us to understanding of diagnostic and treatment that we do not have luxury without a condition. What makes this one of a kind? One, like all the autoimmune diseases, we thought this is a recipe with two ingredients, so that is not unique. You gotta have genes, and you have to have an environmental trigger mismanaged by the immune system because of your genetic makeup. Also, it's not unique the fact that among the genes, these HLA genes, particularly DQ2, DQ8, they got to be there. But here, first peculiarity, diabetes, 60-65% penetrance, multiple sclerosis, 75%. Here, 98-99%. In other words, for practical discussion, you cannot have celiac disease, and we will discuss this later again, if you don't have either one or both. Unique among all autoimmune diseases. Unique also in the biomarkers, because the autoantigen, this strange enzyme called transglutaminase, or TTG, is the target of the autoimmune response. You heard Mike that say, you know, some of these antibodies are promiscuous. You will not find any other condition other than celiac disease that will have high TTG antibodies, with the exception of a handful of autoimmune diseases, specifically type 1 diabetes and autoimmune liver disease, in which you can have a low titer TTG antibodies positivity as a false positive. But when you talk about high levels of TTG, there is no such a thing. So the specificity of this autoantigen and the autoantibodies produced in response to this autoantigen is extremely high. But definitely, what makes celiac disease really one of a kind is the only autoimmune disease for which we know the trigger. We don't know what makes people sick with MS or rheumatoid arthritis or diabetes, but it's undisputably clear that gluten, this strange protein in grains, is the environmental trigger. So much so that this is the only autoimmune disease for which we have a treatment, not a cure, a treatment. As a matter of fact, taking gluten out of the diet or to reintroduce gluten in the diet, you turn on and off the autoimmune process at will. And we use this now for clinical trials, okay? But the elimination of the environmental trigger eliminates completely the autoimmune process and its consequences, unless there were complications during the process. I don't know if you appreciate the depth of what I just said, because that definition and that statement put the entire world of autoimmunity in turmoil. The entire world autoimmune in turmoil. Why? Because now there is a new paradigm of autoimmune diseases. If you look at the classical textbooks of autoimmunity, they said there are a couple of theories for which people develop autoimmunity on a specific genetic background when exposed to the environmental trigger. Either they have antigen mimicry, i.e. that you are exposed to an environmental trigger, let's say a viral infection, a bacterial infection, that has components that are similar but not identical to our body, and therefore we meant to attack and get rid of the invader, but because of the structure similarity, now we attack also component of our body, and that's how you develop autoimmunity, or bystander effect. You cause damage of our own tissue for whatever reason, and self-antigen were sequestered because they are intracellular, and now they leak out. Being naive to the immune system, are attacked by the immune system. Either way, this implies that when you start, there is point of no return. There is no return for autoimmunity because it goes in automatic. Celiac disease as a paradigm of autoimmunity is telling us otherwise. And this will have tremendous implication from the diagnostic purpose of the entire business of autoimmunity. If you look at this, you are not a gastroenterologist, I understand, but there is a tremendous beauty of this. You know what is this? Any clue? Now let me tell you. If you are sick and you see a gastroenterologist and we have to put the tube through your throat to do an endoscopy, this is what we look at. This is your beautiful guts inside out. See how beautiful it is. Pinky, you know, lavish. It's a joy to look at this kind of stuff. If you use a specific and special endoscope that has the possibility to zoom in, when you look at this aspect here, there are this finger-like protrusion because this is not smooth, but these have these valleys and hills. They are the villi. That when you do an endoscopy, again, it's very picturesque. It's very poetic because they move, you know, swinging back and forth, like algae in the water. You know, when the current comes through, it's beautiful. It's absolutely beautiful. And if we take biopsies, this is the typical stuff that we look at. You know, the villi up. The crypts are small, the ratio has to be 3-1, and so on and so forth. If this individual is genetically skewed to develop celiac disease and introduce gluten, sooner or later, you go from the beauty to the beast. Now, you don't have to be a gastroenterologist and a little bit crazy to say that this is yucky. This is just disgusting. You know, it's so unsophisticated and look very sick. And then you look at the villi, and they are short, you know, totally disorganized, they are the blunted and so on and so forth, and then you do the classical stuff here, you see that this villi are almost disappearing. So classical way of thinking would say you go from here to here and you're done. But when you go on a gluten-free diet, you go from here to here. So in other words, Celiac is telling us, look guys, if we have a way to stop this interplay between genes that you're born with an environment, in this case gluten, you can revert the autoimmune process. Think about how revolutionary is this idea that is now slowly but surely sinking into the mind of immunologists. So much so that rather to put the band-aid on the problem, now there's a lot of work to try to see if we can do for other autoimmune diseases what we're doing celiac disease to stop this interplay. Because when these people, they go on a gluten-free diet, okay, and they did not have complications, and they don't share it with you, they have an autoimmune disease, there is absolutely no way, no way. I know there are a couple people here with celiac disease, but if I have to educatively guess who are they look like all the others. They do not have symptoms. If I draw the blood and put in that machine and look at the antibodies for celiac disease, they would test negative. And I'm so nuts to go ahead and do an endoscopy, this is what I'm looking at. Because the target organ is, thank God, an organ that can rejuvenate itself every 4-7 days. That's what the intestine does for living. So they are totally, totally undistinguishable from the other folks. All right? With that premises, what we went from this point on, how we really cash on this kind of information. When we start to look into the details, we realize that the recipe for celiac disease actually is made by 3 ingredients and not 2. And the more we dig into other autoimmune diseases, the more we see this holy trinity. Genes, environment, but also an intestinal barrier that is not working anymore to keep the foes out and leave the friends in. That now becomes promiscuous to everybody's in there, allow them to come all. And therefore, there is no this discriminating, you know, trafficking regulation, so much so that you know, stuff comes in because the intestine is not having that intestinal barrier function to work the way it is supposed to be. So let's take a look at one by one of these 3 factors, because this will have tremendous diagnostic repercussion. Let's start with genetics, okay? Like any autoimmune disease, even celiac disease is a multifactorial condition. So by definition, more than a gene is involved, okay? You got them there all to develop celiac disease. I told you already about the peculiarity of the HLA. Celiac disease will materialize only if you have either one or both this HLA haplotype, DQ2, DQ8, okay? But if you have that, that means that you will have, you know, destiny to develop celiac disease? Absolutely not. Because 1/3 of the Joe Schmoes out there, they also have the HLA DQ2, DQ8. So in other words, these tests is absolutely useless to say, yes, you have or you will be developing celiac disease over time. That's not the use of this test, because if you have this and you lack all the others, you're not going to develop celiac disease. Conversely, if you don't have it and you have all the other genes, you can't complete the puzzle, and therefore you're not going to be able to click with gluten and lead to celiac disease. Meaning that the HLA, DQ2, DQ8 are absolutely necessary, but not sufficient to develop the condition. Positive predictive value, extremely low. Negative predictive value, in other words, if they are not there, you're not going to have a disease, extremely, extremely high. So currently, we send blood tests to lab asking for HLA, DQ2, DQ8, not to confirm the diagnosis, but to rule it out. 2 consequences here. 1, healthcare insurances start to appreciate that the HLA haplotyping is a saving money kind of business. And I'll tell you in a moment. 2, Mike mentioned about this frenzy of genetic testing and so on and so forth, and people that become hypochondriac because now they have the genes that in 25,000 years may not develop lung cancer and so on and so forth. Not here. This is not a test that if you test positive, you will have a precondition that will increase your premium in healthcare, insurance, or that will make you nuts to say, oh my gosh, I'm going to develop celiac disease at some point, because again, you may, it just tells you it can be genetically compatible, provided you have all the others. So there is no such a risk, but it's tremendously important to know how to manage people that are at risk of celiac disease from there on. That's what is so important about this test. What we know about genetics? Well, with these new techniques like the GWAS studies, we start to really learn the other piece of the puzzle. And here, there are two examples, IBD and celiac disease, that simplify a concept. Stop wasting your mind and time to look for the genes of autoimmunity. It's not going to happen. The reason why, because the more we look into this, the more we realize that probably we are dealing with hundreds, if not thousands, of genes that are involved in this. And the matter of fact, the more we learn, for example, now we got up to 27 genes that have been found for celiac disease, you know, linkage, and there are similar number for IBD, is that they can be categorized in specific classes. So we know that you need genes for innate immunity involved. You know that you need genes for adaptive immune involved. You need genes that are related to inflammation. And you need genes for intestinal barrier dysfunction. But these genes can change from one population to another, and even without the same family, can be different, provided that they are from each of these categories, so you have the right genetic soup to be genetically predisposed for autoimmunity. Chance exists that within each category, there is a tremendous permutation in the genes. They do the same business. You know, gene A has to do with innate immunity, gene B has to do with innate immunity. One is present in one patient, the other present in the other patient. Bottom line, genome-wise screening for diagnostic purposes to see where is the soup, the genes that you're going to have to develop celiac disease would not be your business. It's not going to happen. And finally, we came to this realization. This is going to be just a scientific exercise, but not something that you will see in the pipeline coming thrilling down to your labs. I don't think this is going to happen. Okay, so if you were putting yourself in that kind of mood, change your mind. The single gene, business like you know, cystic fibrosis and the gene for risk for breast cancer, maybe, but not autoimmunity. Now, this is definitely the second ingredient of the recipe of the Holy Trinity, in which we just start learning a little bit. And again, I'm going to give you a snapshot of what's going to come in the pipeline coming down in your operation. There is a lot of facts and a lot of fantasies here because, unfortunately, this term that I hate, leaky gut, has been vilified, tremendously vilified by alternative medicine folks and your quote-unquote colleagues that work in interesting labs and interesting place of the country. I'm not going to name it, but, you know, Mike alluded to, you know, when you do the 25,000, you know, screening for selenium and cobalt, you know, intoxication and so on and so forth, they also do testing for leaky gut, okay? But what are the fats? The intestine is a long tube, as my student taught me, 20 feet long. When, a while ago, I'm talking about 20 years ago, it was conceptualized as a long tube covered by single layer cells. And these cells were all, you know, fused together to offer a superb, impermeable barrier to the bad guys out there. As a matter of fact, when we taught, you know, about the gut, we used to say conceptualize it as a sort of floor in which each cell is a tile, and then there is grout in between cells that seal them all so that nothing can go through other than through the cell. And that's what the concept of the intestine until in the late 80s. Just to give a magnitude, if I take the gut of each and every you guys and lie on the floor, you cover a double tennis court. You're talking about 3,000 square feet, so by far, it's the largest interface that we have with the environment, by far. Then in the late 80s, a Japanese group came into the picture and said, guys, there is no grout in between cells. There are gates. Almost closed all the time. So that's the reason why foes, they don't come in, because they are closed. But because there are doors, gates, that means that once in a while, when we need, we can open them up. to do stuff that we didn't understand at that time. What we didn't realize, what these gates are doing for a living, and most importantly, the key that command these gates to be open or closed, that was pretty much the unknown until year 2000. So we're talking about 10 years ago, not a huge amount of time ago, in which we discovered this molecule that's called zonulin, that's what it does for a living. This is a molecule that helped the intestine to decide who is friend that can come in and who is foe and needs to be out. And when everything works right, this molecule does an unbelievable job to help protecting us, okay? What is this molecule? What kind of molecule we're talking about? This is an interesting story, and I want to give you a few details because this is one of the biomarkers of autoimmunity that will be used routinely in the lab setting. This is a question of time, but we have been using this in our R&D. It's had so much validation that now this is mature for the big stage. And you will see this coming your way sometime soon. The most interesting start is the genetic. I mean, this is a molecule that is extremely ancient. The prototype of this molecule appeared roughly 450 million years ago when fish split out from the rest of the animal kingdom. But the real zonulin, i.e. the molecule that we're talking about, is a descendant of this guy here that is called optoglobin 1 that, by the way, was used as a biomarker of inflammation many, many years ago. You guys are all too young to remember that. But before that, we send the blood to your lab to ask for CRP and sed rate. What we use as a biomarker of inflammation was optoglobin. That was the major use. Now we don't use that anymore because we have a more efficient way to look for inflammatory biomarkers. We use optoglobin for genetic reasons because it's a very strange gene, change all the time, so we can do a lot of genetic stuff with that. But look at this. Optoglobin 1, it was the ancestor of zonulin, and then when optoglobin 2, that turns to be zonulin, appeared 2 million years ago, 500,000 years after that human beings and chimpanzees split out. Did you hear what Mike said in terms of how many autoimmune diseases we human beings are affected to, roughly 80? How many autoimmune diseases do you think the chimpanzees are affected of? Give me an educated guess. App? Zero. Chimpanzees, they do not have autoimmunity. We're freaking close to chimpanzees. Even if we behave differently, there are only 400 genes that make the difference between us as chimpanzees. This is one of the 400. What is interesting is that this gene came to the fruition because, you know, originally, 450 million years ago, there was this genetic arrangement, there was this ancestor, and then there was another, you know, molecule that was optoglobin-related protein, and then this beautiful gene, optoglobin, chimpanzee. And then when we split from the chimpanzee, we lost this. We had the variant of this guy here that is, you know, the zonulin, and now we have it, and the chimpanzees, they don't. You know, the characterization of this molecule was fascinating, and matter of fact, this is a story that is unbelievable. This is just out of curiosity, because this is going to be the way that we will look for these biomarkers. You know, this was originally a Western blot on the sera of some people that had celiac disease, because we were able to find out that people with celiac disease produce 10 times more zonulin than just more out there. And then we have found, indeed, that these bands here, this belongs to, you know, optoglobin 2, i.e. zonulin, and this belongs to the ancestor, i.e. optoglobin 1. The gene for zonulin is sitting on chromosome 16. Really interesting chromosome. I mean, it's rather small, contains roughly 98 million bases, 3% of the human genome, 1,300 genes, that's all, of the 35,000 that we have. That's it. But there are a lot of genes that have been identified on that chromosome that are related to autoimmunity, cancer, and disease in the nervous system. I'm going to just focus here because that's what we're talking about. So genes for lupus, type 1 diabetes, rheumatoid arthritis, they sit on this chromosome 16. Now, using zonulin as a biomarker, we already have been able to find out that zonulin has association with the same category of diseases. But again, just focus just a second about this. Ankylosis spondylitis, celiac disease, Crohn's disease, but not ulcerative colitis, rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, and type 1 diabetes. Of the diseases in the immune system, we start to see data that we're accumulating with multiple sclerosis, and now by all means, we know it to be an autoimmune disease, and schizophrenia that is extremely interesting to me because now there is also a move to switch this fellow here from disease of the nervous system to a truly autoimmune disease. As a matter of fact, if you look at the distribution of the three phenotypes, in other words, if you are homozygous for haptoglobin 1, so you don't produce zonulin, or you are heterozygous, means that you produce one copy of zonulin, or you're homozygous for haptoglobin 2, i.e. you produce two molecules of zonulin, in the general population, this is the distribution in controls. These are two different studies, Europe, United States, and you see the distribution. The vast majority of the folks, they have a certain number of roughly between 50 and 20%. They do not produce zonulin in the general population. The vast majority, roughly half, produce the heterozygous, and then the remaining produce the homozygous. But look what happened to the patients with schizophrenia and celiac disease. Most of them, they lost or, you know, much less represented as zonulin negative, you know, between a third or half. But a vast majority, more than half now, are homozygous for zonulin, suggesting that the more copies of this molecule you have, the higher your risk for both celiac disease and schizophrenia. Okay? Now, the second ingredient in the recipe, i.e. permeability, is now start to really get the attention because with the GWAS genome, we start to see there are genes related to permeability. And now this is a list, by far not a complete list, of conditions in which we know that there is a breach in the intestinal barrier. And why we thought before there was an epiphenomenon, so you know this is close vis-a-vis with the autoimmunity, now we start to see that these are integral changes in the pathogenesis of autoimmunity. You need that as well, besides genes and the environmental trigger to develop autoimmunity. The third element, this is fascinating. So what you see here is the environmental trigger that I told you we know about celiac disease being gluten. These are the tribes of the grass family. Of all the tribes, only this one here, the ordate, which wheat, rye, and barley belong to, contain grains that have gluten and therefore are offending for people with celiac disease. All the others, they do not. They do not. What is the peculiarity here? The peculiarity is that they've been around for a million years. This just came out very recently. For 2.5 years of evolution, humankind has been gluten-free. We do not been built to deal with gluten. Gluten came into the picture only 10,000 years ago when the humankind changed lifestyle from nomadic, chasing food and animals, to settlers when both food, crops, and animal were domesticated. And when we start to play with crops, we start to mix and match them, and that's how gluten-containing grains were created. So we are not built to deal with gluten. As a matter of fact, the more we look into this molecule, the more we ask ourselves, what is so special about gluten? What is so special about this molecule? It's, again, in the perspective of the general concept, the celiac disease is one of a kind, it's a one of a kind molecule. It's very unique. First of all, while you talk about gluten, you don't talk about the protein, where you talk a mixture of proteins. The two key proteins are gliadin, that is definitely the most toxic component of gluten, and then there is this other component, glutenin. These together form this unbelievable network of fibers and chambers in which, you know, gliadin is accommodated. that gives the unique organoleptic characteristic of gluten. Have you ever tried to eat a piece of bread made out of rice? You know what I'm talking about? Puffy, crunchy, smelly, forget it. It's flat. It does, you know, puff. And the reason why, because rice does not have the capability to entrap air that makes bread to become whatever it is, cakes to be really nice and fluffy, pizza that is one of a kind. I mean, even if the American pizza is just not as good. But still, you can't just make the pizza with maize or you know, rice. It doesn't really do it, okay? And that's the reason why. And that's the reason why there is no substitute. And the reason why gluten is so promiscuous worldwide in terms of use is because of this organic capability and the flexibility of what you can do with gluten. There is no other grain that allows you to make pizza, pasta, cookie, bagels, one of the most popular drink, i.e. beer. This is all come from one single crop, gluten. As a matter of fact, in an ancient time, when we did not have stocks and bonds, what was the value, the money at that time? It was measured in jars of, you know, wheat. That was it. Not perishable, extremely flexible in terms of what you can do with that, and easy to harvest. So that's the reason why this was gold and had this vast, vast distribution worldwide. Why so unique? Because this damn protein is made by a sequence of amino acids that are one of a kind, extremely rich in prolamin and glutamine. There is only one protein that we cannot dismantle completely in its single element that we put in our mouth. Only one, and that's this one here. If you're so nuts to put a tube in your nose, go in your stomach, and take some of the juice out of there that contain acid and some enzymes, and put in a little, you know, glass, you put the little bit of finger that you put in there, in a matter of 15 seconds, your finger is gone, will go to the bone. You put gluten, after 12 hours, it's still there, goes nowhere. Now, you appreciate why this is so dangerous, because the immune system will not see the single amino acid. It has to see the stretch of amino acids still together, i.e. peptides, to be interpreted as a known self-antigen. And now we start to map, this is the molecule gliding, of some of these stretches. For example, this guy here, it's cytotoxic. If you take this piece of gluten and you put with a cell, the cell would die. This piece stretch here are 33 amino acids. This is capable to activate the immune system in everybody, not just celiac, everybody. You harm immune cells. These two guys here, they make cells to release zonulin and therefore make an intestine leak. Leakier than it's supposed to be. This guy here, it turns to be a peptide that can release IL-8, a chemokine that will call in soldiers like neutrophils and will cause inflammation. So see how much danger this molecule can do as the third element of the, you know, all the trinity here. So if this is the battlefield, this is what we understand right now that will lead to my final part of discussion of diagnostic, where we are and where we're going. This is the battlefield. The first event, the epithelial events, the ones that happen on the battlefield are stuff that happened in a few hours, and everybody, no one in this room is spared of this. When you ingest and eat gluten, your Big Mac comes in, you make the intestine to release zonulin and leak. The people that have no other problem, this leak is temporary, so you open the doors and they close immediately, and the immune system and the guts take care of the mess. And actually, this turns to be good because we train our immune system to recognize not only gluten, because when you open the door, everybody comes in, but other stuff that is in there, so that if something goes really wrong with an infection and so on and so forth, our soldiers have been primed and they know what to do. If beside that, you start to engage an immune response of the innate immune branch, so it's sustained enough that now we see this uncontrolled leakness of enemies coming in, the innate immune system branch will be activated and we start to produce a response that in general is a controlled inflammation that stays in the gut. So this is not Las Vegas right here, okay? It stays there. Now, if, and this in general takes days, if you're genetically skewed to develop celiac disease, and therefore you have those genetic makeups that make you to mismanage the situation, then you engage the third part of these elements, so the adaptive immune response. This may take weeks, months, even years. And at this point, what you do, you start to arm your immune system. You activate both the humoral, i.e. autoantibodies, and cell-mediated immune response. You produce chemicals like cytokine and chemokine that eventually, if they have as a final target intestine, they are there, you develop the damage typical of celiac disease that I showed you before. But because this is not Las Vegas anymore, some of these guys will move out and will spread around and will target any tissue organ of your or your body, as you will see in a moment. Because there is this celiac disease is a systemic disease, it's not a GI disease. When these three elements they come together, gluten, genetic makeup, and lost intestinal barrier, you end up to the clinical outcome. Once again, another peculiarity about celiac disease. What is so peculiar? The people that have celiac disease, they are pretty much simplified now as part of this family, the celiac iceberg. To belong to the family, there are some musts that we need to have from the lab. The lab has to tell us, this guy is genetically susceptible. I have to have either one or both these genes. This guy has to have a positive autoantibodies as biomarkers of the autoimmunity ongoing. These are the minimal requirements. If the lab is telling us that both fulfill the criteria, this fellow is part of this family. If on top of that, the autoimmune insult, i.e. the damage of the intestine already is in the making, and this individual has symptoms, it's going to be on the top of the iceberg because it will be the visible part of the problem. Is the individual that is sick, go to the doctor and say, something's wrong with me. What is challenging about this is that the vast majority of the problem is underneath the line of water. With this form, for example, that's called silent celiac disease, with people little or no symptoms, again, they got to have genetics and serology, that's a must. They have already the damage, but they are still clinically silent. How that can happen? Well, if you have a target organ 20 feet that you damage a small amount that doesn't do anything special, the rest of the intestine can subsidize, you don't have symptoms. And finally, this is the latent form in which the genetics there, the autoimmune is there, but no damage to the mucosa quite yet. You take a snapshot, 100 people, 50 will be here, 40 will be here, and only 10 of the celiacs will be clinically apparent that will go to the doctor. If I came 6 months ago, I would have told also, this is the journey that each individual with celiac disease would take. You're born with a gene, then baby food is introduced in your diet, and forget about if you are from China, that's not true. 100% of the time, no matter where you live, gluten is introduced at weaning. Because the gluten is so promiscuous, it's not just the pasta. There's going to be gluten in soy sauce, there's going to be gluten as an additive, it's everywhere. There is no point in the planet that don't use gluten. So we thought when these two, they come together, i.e. when baby foods comes into the picture, that's when the clock starts clicking for the autoimmune process. That's when this happened. Now, at that point, so within the first year of life, you become part of the family. And there are people that make this journey all the way up in very short period of time, few weeks or months, and these are the ones, the cases in pediatrics, the babies in the first year of life that develop celiac disease. And there are people that make the journey in 70 years, and we thought, oh, the immune system is a little bit slower to make these people to move from the bottom to the top, and therefore we take more time. But that's what was our interpretation, because the dogma was, when the two are together, that's it. This is where it starts. This is typically what we had in mind as celiac disease, okay? When I was in training, I was told, you know, fellow, let me tell you what celiac disease is all about. Has to be a kid. Has to be a fair skin. Not just European. It got to be from the north. I mean, you know, white, blonde hair. Has to be within the first 2 years of life. Got to have GI symptoms. Particularly diarrhea, big belly, lack of appetite, failed to try, weight loss, stomach ache, and so on and so forth. I was told this, irritability is a common denominator. These kids are big time pissed off. And matter of fact, he said, forget about the lap. If you have a kid that's a wacko, and you have parents with hair up in the eye, that's celiac disease unless proved otherwise. You do the test just for confirming that. Now, this is a picture of celiacs in the late 30s from UK. Have you ever seen a malnourished kids from the third world country? They look exactly the same. Exactly the same. Those kids, they look like this because they have no food to eat. They have no food available. These kids, they look like those because they do have the food. They cannot make use of it. It just goes through, because it's not digested and absorbed. So they have this big belly, subcutaneous fat gut, muscle wasting, by the way, pissed off right there, see? Right there. For many, many years, we considered this the paradigm of celiac disease. And based on that, the statement of celiac disease does not exist in the United States was held true. Because you're not gonna see this. I haven't seen a case like this in 15 years. When in the, just to put this in a chronological perspective, in the mid-90s, we start to question the business. The general concept of celiac disease in the United States was it's extremely rare, not existing. You need to read this in medical school as an addendum, and then there was a note, by the way, you're not gonna see this anyhow. There was like an agreement or a decision that was made, I don't know, by God, nature, whatever, that was sitting in the middle of Atlantic Ocean and said, all the celiacs on the left in Europe, all the IBS and Crohn's disease on the right in the United States. That was the perception at that time. And then we realized that this is not celiac disease, but this is celiac disease. Bottom line, there is no organ or tissue that is spared. Because when you have immune cells harmed, they can go everywhere. They can go to your skin, they can go to your brain, they can go to your joint, they can go to your bones, you name it. So there is a tremendous permutation of the way this disease presents itself. To the point that I personally define the celiac, you know, as a clinical chameleon. There are two papers that I wrote. There are use and abuse in the literature. This is one. This clinical chameleon now has become a buzzword. The other one was in 95, when I started to really dig into this. 95, there were no labs certified to do celiac testing. I had to have my lab CLIA certified, and you know what that means. It was a nightmare, okay? And I wrote a paper in 95, and the title was, where are all the American celiacs gone? Where are they? Where are they? Now, you know that this is widely accepted, that it's extremely frequent, so on and so forth. So we went from this, an epidemiology concept of old school that says it's rare, it's only in kids, it's a wide incidence that's fluctuating in space and in time. You gotta be, again, of North European origin, to a different concept. How we learn that? Thanks to the diagnostics. Only when we start to have tools to look into the magnitude of the problem with diagnostics, we discover the minds of celiac disease. Starting relatives, of course, because it's a genetic disorder. You know, symptoms that we define once in a while and a long time ago as atypical, where we know that now this is typical. Anemia, by the way, is the most frequent way that the disease presents itself nowadays, and with that, fatigue. Comorbidities with other autoimmune and genetic disorders, and then we look at this in the big picture, the healthy population, and now we understand the magnitude of the problem. This was the cornerstone that planted the flag of celiac disease in the United States. We went from 1 in 10,000 before this study to this number that you will see over and over again, 1 in 133. When was this published? 2003. Not 1883, 2003, okay? Before this, the business of diagnosis of celiac disease was non-existent. We didn't ask for it. There was nothing, nothing. And then, of course, if you are at risk because you have symptoms or you're first or second degree, you go up to 4, 10%, and so on and so forth. Third peculiarity about celiac disease. How many people with diabetes been diagnosed? In your opinion, how many people that suffer type 1 diabetes are currently diagnosed? What percentage?
All of them.
All of them, because otherwise you die. The ones that you don't diagnose, they out-eliminate themselves. 95% of people with celiac disease, of the 3 million projected people with celiac disease, are not diagnosed. This is a 2005 slides. Here was 2%, 40,000 people. Now we're roughly at 200,000 people. Still, the vast majority of people are not diagnosed yet. They have it, but not been diagnosed. That's another peculiarity about celiac disease. How are you going to look for these people? How are you going to search for these people? If we look at the WHO criteria or general screening of the entire population in the United States, you got to satisfy these 5 criteria. Early detection of the disease could be difficult on a clinical basis. I told you this is a clinical chameleon, so it's very difficult just on a clinical basis to make the diagnosis. Diabetes is easy. You pee too much, you drink too much, you are highlight at it, chance exists that you have diabetes. But here, it's too vague to make the diagnosis just on a clinical ground. So this is satisfied. Gotta be frequent, and needs to really cause significant morbidity in the general population. There is no such a disease like this. 1% of the general population, guys. 1%. 3 million people. Diabetes, there are 400,000. Crohn's disease, there are 450,000. You know, multiple sclerosis, 280,000. 3 million. 3 million people. This has got to be dear to you here. You got to have a test that's highly sensitive, specific, otherwise, you can't have a return on investment to screen them all. And we will get back to this, but this is one of the best tests that I challenge you have in your pipeline. There is no such a thing with such high sensitivity and specificity as this test here. Of course, if you don't have a treatment available, screening everybody is a waste of time and money in terms of public health. And definitely, we have a treatment here that we don't have with other autoimmune diseases. And last but not least, that if you do not diagnose, you're going to get in deep doo-doo. And again, indeed, people with celiac disease, if not diagnosed, will have comorbidities that you don't want to deal with. As a matter of fact, the overall mortality of an undiagnosed celiac is 2.5-fold higher than the general population. Goes back to the general population numbers when they go on a gluten-free diet. So what are we going to do? We're going to screen them all. Or we target what we call people at risk, so what is called the case finding. Well, we did this study using the kit of some of your folks there to screen people with celiac disease in a large primary care network in North America, United States and Canada. 45 primary pediatricians and internists were asked to participate. And we told them, if anybody walk in your office with bloating, chronic fatigue, IBS, constipation, pain, thyroid disease, blah, 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 you go through the list. We pay for it, screen them for celiac disease. Expected prevalence is this column here, 1%. Everything on the right, you got to screen for it. Top of the list, thyroid disease, Hashimoto. Family history, GI symptoms, iron deficiency, chronic fatigue. In other words, anybody with this, you know, kind of situation got to be screened for celiac disease because it's cost effective. Cost effective. And matter of fact, we can dictate guidelines to colleagues how to handle this. They know too well now that this is what you need to have in mind. If you do a cost analysis, how much is going to cost for each diagnosis? Okay, this is the cost analysis of the study that we've done. For each diagnosed individual, $6,000. Do you think that this was a good buy or not? Was a good deal or was a bad deal? Who believes that this was a bad deal? Raise your hand. Who believes that it's a good deal? Raise your hand. The rest don't care. Okay. The average time between the onset of symptoms and an individual being diagnosed with celiac disease, even now, is 7 years. The average expense that you and I, as a society, we pay for this individual, it's a little bit more than $100,000. So $6,000 is a great deal. It's a great deal. Because these people, they have symptoms and they consume the healthcare system. We are at the verge of a change how we do business here. You know, we, with the healthcare reform, you like it or not, with what is going to be in the pipeline, we're not going to be able to do business as we've done so far. It's not sustainable over time. This is the way to do it. And celiac disease definitely offer a unique paradigm of how a shift of business model needs to be really implemented. In only one year, in this network, there was an increase of roughly 40-fold increase. 1 year. These are the same folks that before the study were so skeptical and said, I haven't seen a celiac in ages. You're wasting your time. Go now and tell one of these 43 doctors, look, I'm here today because I'm picking my nose twice rather than once a day. And this guy said, you know what? You got to screen celiac disease, fellow. This is what's wrong with you. And I receive, still today, 2 years after the study, this was done in 2007, 3 years after the study, emails from these people that keep saying, colleagues, where were they? They are coming out of the woods. I got, you know, a lot of celiacs now in my practice. And the question is, did you look for it? No, now you look for it. That's the reason why they're coming out. Talk about Googling. I am a computer illiterate. I'm actually a dummy. I don't even buy dummy for computer for dummies because I don't even understand that. So my son that is 11, a while ago, told me about Google Trend. Have you ever heard that? Google Trend? Oh, it's beautiful. You go in there and you put any kind of queries, in this case, for example, celiac disease, United States. And what you see here is this line. Interestingly enough, before 2003, that was the year of our study, there was no trace of celiac disease. And then you see here this nice, cute increase and this big peak over here and so on and so forth. Roughly now it's 180,000 people, shy of 200,000. And you know, celiac disease diagnosis really increased over time. Now, talking with some of your colleagues, I also been told that the business of celiac disease screening also ballooning. Let me make a statement that maybe didn't dunt in your mind. This is not like any other disease that you're dealing with. Any other autoimmune disease that you're dealing with, or infectious disease, or whatever you do in the lab, is a single shot. You do the test, you diagnose the individual, it's positive, negative, it's done deal. This is accruing over time. Because in our guideline, we, physicians, we told to our colleagues, if you diagnose somebody with celiac disease, this individual, every year for the rest of his life, needs to be tested for the autoantibodies to check on compliance and diet. That's the reason why you see these numbers going to the wazoo. Because Today you have one, tomorrow you have 10, then you have 100, they have 1,000, and then 10,000, because they will accrue over time. This is not a single shot. This is a client that will stay in your pipeline forever until we change the guidelines, if we change the guidelines. So be nice with me. That increase was interpreted by me and many other colleagues as increase of awareness. The people, that column, the yellow column that was so low, was starting to come up. And they said, this is why we see more patients, we see more diagnostics materializing. That's the reason why the prevalence is increasing over time. Until 6 months ago, when we do this study, that really put me out of balance. Because again, I was absolutely sure that equation that I told you, you're born with the genes, you got gluten, and it's a question of time. You will develop celiac disease, but the autoimmune process starts there. We have a cohort of 35 adults that we've been following since the 70s for other reasons. And we wanted to rewrite the natural history of celiac disease, how you move through that iceberg toward the top. That was the purpose of this study. And we reasoned, we screened these people in 74. We've been following these people until 2008 with questionnaires. So we will see the fellows that were positive in 74, how they move towards, you know, the tip of the iceberg and how they develop the symptoms. That was the purpose of this study. That's all. So we said 74, we find a certain number of people, we see how they will do over time. When we screened this in 74, we found 7 positive. When we screened the same population, so there is no genetic variation here, 89, we found twice as many. And I told my folks, you made a mistake here, guys. It's not possible. There is no way that an adult would develop celiac disease, you know, in its adulthood. This 7 got to stay 7 over time. Can be there is increase. We look at this on and on again. And guess what, guys? In this cohort, in which the genetic variability has been taken out, because these are the same geosmos, the same genes, celiac disease doubled every 15 years. 1 in 500 in 74, 1 in 250 in the 90s, 1% in the 2000. You know what that means? It is not destiny. If you have all the genes, it is not destiny that you develop autoimmunity. It is not destiny. There are people that for 68 years have been eating gluten, the culprit, and been tolerating it. And then something happened to them that made them to lose tolerance and develop autoimmunity in their mid-70s. Meaning that if you guys will help us to understand the tricks that these people that tolerate gluten for so long, by identifying biomarkers of tolerance, or vice versa, to find when they lost tolerance, biomarkers that will make them shift from tolerance to immune response, you give me the Holy Grail, the power that I thought I had in my hand since I was in medical school. I walk on water, I have the healing power. Back to me, because my self-confidence went to the toilet during these years. Because this will be the paradigm of preventive medicine. This will be the way, really, that we're moving forward. Because the story is written. We can't read it, but it's there. That's what these studies are telling us. Let me wrap it up and finish up with current and future trends in terms of the diagnostics and what will be, in my humble opinion, a business model of the future in terms of diagnostic of autoimmunity. This is an embarrassing slide, but I need to present it. Confirm diagnosis before treating. What a concept. It's like to say, going back to the parallel of diabetes, I pee a little bit too much, I drink a little bit too much, I shoot myself with 20 units of insulin because I want to see if I have diabetes. You don't do that. people with celiac disease, they do. In other words, thanks to this blessed Google, and Mike alluded to this, if I am having problems, and for 7 years, my doctors really didn't find out what was wrong with me, and I put the list of my symptoms, and the first thing that hits the list of possible causes, celiac disease, so first question is, how do you spell it? Second question, what the heck is that? And third, of course, what do you do about it? And what you do about it is you go on a gluten-free diet. And you know too well, going on a gluten-free diet, you kiss goodbye to my biomarkers. They are gone. I can't make the diagnosis anymore. So, you know, this is a concept that we're trying to hammer over and over again to our patients, to our healthcare professional colleagues, and so on and so forth. Because, you know, if you go on a gluten-free diet, you don't have celiac disease, you affect in a negative way your lifestyle. No question. Because, you know, try it. It's not a walk in the park. Feasible, but it's definitely affecting your lifestyle. On the other hand, if you don't diagnose and you're on a regular diet, you also affect negatively your quality of life because increased morbidity and mortality. This is the list, the complete list of the serological tests that have been in the pipeline, either currently or past, for celiac disease. Starting from the oldest, anti-gliadin antibodies, to finish to the most frequent, the anti-tissue transglutaminase of two generations. First generation doesn't exist anymore. The guinea pig protein, it doesn't exist anymore. There is only the second generation. Quickly, anti-gliadin antibodies, we do not use this anymore, ever, for the diagnosis of celiac disease. They are not specific because any kind of reaction that you have to gluten in the gluten spectrum disorders, you would test positive for this. The only thing that the positive antibodies would tell you here is, one, you're eating gluten, two, somehow gluten sneaks through the intestinal barrier, three, the immune system did its job, non-self antigen, mounted immune response. That's all. If you have a rotavirus infection, if you had wheat allergy, if you have gluten sensitivity, if you have celiac disease, if you have a parasite, or just you have an upset stomach, these are all conditions in which this can happen. So it's not discriminatory between celiac disease and all these other scenarios. That's the reason why we do not use first generation old anti-gliadin antibodies anymore for celiac disease. They are resurfacing now for other forms of gluten reaction, but not for celiac disease. Of course, they are cheap and easy to perform, and I just told you the poor sensitivity and specificity. This is the guy that changed completely the landscape of celiac disease and help us to, quote unquote, find the minds of celiac disease. The anti-dimethylamine antibodies, it's an immunofluorescent assay, highly sensitive in specificity, tremendous disadvantages that Mike alluded to. You know, it's operator dependent, it's extremely expensive, time consuming. Of course, you know, if you're IgA deficient, like other, you know, other antibodies for celiac disease, you will have false negative. But most importantly, you know, it's tremendous effort on the microscope, particularly if you have a large volume as we have nowadays. 10 years ago, maybe, when you have a handful of tests coming in your lab. But now with hundreds of months coming, this is not feasible. And of course, I don't know if you can see that with the light, but you know, this is what you face. You know, this is a negative and it's positive. And then, of course, this is on monkey esophagus substrate. No problem in making the diagnosis here. This is clearly positive, this is clearly negative. But you have here this autofluorescence, for example, that can really skew your understanding. You can call this positive, while this is not. And this is positive. So, you know, this is the kind of challenging that you go when this test is done by not skilled, you know, technicians, and when you have to do this in big volumes and you have to rush stuff through and so on and so forth. Definitely this guy made the change. You know, we're talking about the ones that are commercially available. By the way, this was developed in Maryland. We cloned the human gene for TTG. The one that you use now in the lab was the results of the study that was materialized at Maryland. Great sensitivity, great specificity, non-operator dependent, relatively cheap. There are some still disadvantages, particularly in the young kids below 2 years of age, but these now are rare cases. While in the past, as I told you, there was the bulk of the cases, now below two are rare. IgA deficiency, of course, is not going to work. And there's the chance that in good hands, is not as specific, and the anti-mechanism antibodies in specific subgroups that I'll tell you in a moment. The deaminated anti-gliadin antibodies, by all means, they behave roughly like the tissue transglutaminase. These are the second generation. They don't look for anti-gliadin antibodies. They look for the byproducts of the presence of tissue transglutaminase. One of the things that does for living this enzyme is to deamidate gliadin, so that brings the glutamine to become a glutamic acid. Now, what you see here is the difference in sensibility based on degree of intestinal atrophy. The black column is total villous atrophy, and in white is partial villous atrophy, so more severe, less severe damage. And you see here, the second generation compared to the first generation. See, this first generation, they don't work well. But the second generation, by all means, particularly for the total villous atrophy, they behave like the TTG, pretty much. And roughly, they behave the same with partial villous atrophy. Okay? What is the advantage of the deamidated anti-gliadin antibodies in the IgG subclass? So in other words, in people with IgA deficiency, TTG, they don't perform too well. The anti-gliadin, deamidated anti-gliadin antibody, the TTG, seems to perform a little bit better, but still not even close to the sensitivity of the IgA subclass. Okay, that to keep in mind. And this is the difference in when you go on a gluten-free diet, i.e. the disappearance. Remember, I told you, we check periodically to check compliance. When you go on a gluten-free diet, this is when you have gluten in black, when you take gluten away in white, you see there is a nice drop with the new generation here, but it's not as nice that you see with the TTG. So apparently, for follow-up, the anti-TTG antibodies seems to be better because they give less false positive than these guys here for people that are properly on a gluten-free diet. But by all means, they are pretty much equivalent. And I think that these are still too preliminary data. We need to have more data in the future to see if there is really an advantage one versus the other. And this is just to, this is so simple that I don't want to spend time. This is very clear to you here. But just to say, what is the difference between two? The anti-TTG antibodies look at this step number 4. You have a damage, you have TTG that leaks out the fibroblast, and now you have an immune response, the B cells that produce specific antibodies against TTG. When TTG leaks out, and therefore is visible by the immune system, it would deamidate gliadin, and now we make deamidated gliadin as a byproduct, so you are a step remote, but the meaning is the same, because now you have these new epitopes, B cells, they see it, and then produce antibodies against deamidated gliadin. But you cannot have this, the deamidated anti-gliadin antibodies, if you don't have this, i.e. TTG that is leaking out the cells, and therefore antibodies against it. So you see here, sensitivity and specificity, I challenge you to tell me any other biomarkers that you have in your pipeline that works like these guys. I mean, we're talking about almost perfection here. At least that's what we believed, okay? But definitely, they perform extremely well, extremely well. If you find somebody with a TTG of 100, there is no other autoimmune disease that will come with this kind of test positive. You can be reassured that you're dealing with celiac disease. There is nothing like, the ANA antibodies, the current business here. I told about the HLA test that is extremely valuable to rule out, so no legal problem there. And this is a test that you will see more and more requested from providers, because this is a cost-effective way to do clinical care. We'll save money. What are the indication? Most importantly, this category here, asymptomatic relative. In other words, when we diagnose somebody with celiac disease, the mandate is to screen the rest of the household for celiac disease. And the question systematically comes to us is, if it's negative, if my son is negative, if my daughter is negative, if I'm negative when my son have celiac disease, what's next? As I told you, you're not out of the woods. You can develop this in the 70s. So the question is, Do I need to check these people on a regular basis, every year, every 2 years, or should I just let it go? If you have the HLA, you can answer that question. So if you have the HLA and you're positive, yes, you need to keep an eye on it and test regularly. If it's HLA negative, it's pizza party time. This fellow would not develop celiac disease. So you spare the money of screening over and over again. And then these other situations are diagnostic dilemmas and so on and so forth. I'm going to finish up with a couple algorithms. These are the current guidelines. So if you have sinus symptoms related to celiac disease, and the history and the frequency exam really make celiac disease as a possible diagnosis, first and foremost, you do TTG IgA plus total IgA to rule out celiac disease, IgA deficiency. That's exactly what we recommend right now. Total IgA and TTG IgA. Now, take TTG IgA, put the amidated antigliding antibodies, we're talking about the same story. Abnormal? No, this is unlikely. Yes, you send to the specialist for endoscopy. If the endoscopy, you finalize the diagnosis, going to gluten-free diet. If it's negative, then you need to review the pathology, consider a reflex of the anti-demesium antibodies to establish if this was a false positive. You do the HLA, repeated biopsy, and so on and so forth. If you're dealing with special folks, and specifically type 1 diabetes, autoimmune thyroiditis, some of this genetic disorder, you do TTG, but if the TTG is positive, before to do the biopsy, you need to ask yourself, does this fellow has diabetes or Hashimoto? Because these are the two conditions which you can have falsely positive TTG, okay? Only in these cases, we do reflex with the anti-demesium antibodies before the endoscopy. Because if they have a TTG of 20, 25, with a cutoff of 11, this may be a false positive. If it's positive, then you go for endoscopy, resonance, so on and so forth. If it's negative, then you have to reconsider that, okay? So that's the current, you know, stuff. I want to let you know that the epidemiology milestones, the progress of what we understand about celiac disease goes vis-a-vis with the, you know, the development of diagnostics. Started from the antigliding antibodies that was the only tool that we have at that time to the deamidated antigliding antibodies that we have right now. So they move vis-a-vis, and this is what's going to happen in the pipeline. Pearls that will come your way that you need to be aware, strongly aware. Have anybody seen this? Have you guys seen this? Thank God. What this looks like? What this looks like? Pregnancy test, indeed. This has been now commercialized in Canada, and the company that makes this is pushing to bring this in the United States. This is a home TTG test. So you guys are out of business here. Two windows, a stripe control, and then the other window that if you're positive, you look like this. If you're negative, you look like this. It stinks. It absolutely stinks because there are tremendous false positive, false negative. And it really makes us physicians driving absolutely nuts because these people, after they go Google, they go to the drugstore, they buy this, they see something like that, and that's it. They put themselves on a gluten-free diet. No meaning to have this here. No reason because this is dangerous. I see only two potential applications with a big question mark. One, if you're already diagnosed with all the rings and bells and then you go on vacation and you feel sick because you believe that you're being quote-unquote glutenized, you may try that. But again, it's a, you know, it's an educated guess. The second is the one that we use this. We develop something very like this for large epidemiological studies in a situation which you don't have a lab, North Africa. We done a screening in the desert where the closest lab was 150 miles. There is no electricity there. So this is a proxy that we use. And that's how we learn that this doesn't work, okay? So be aware about that. Number two, Again, I don't have any kind of legal or economical link with Prometheus or Bio-Rad, whatever. But if you go on www.myceliacid.com, Prometheus is commercializing this do-yourself home saliva-based genetic test. For only $329, you spit on the crap and you will know if you're HLA compatible or not. Be aware, because this is not a great test, okay? So if somebody will come to you and say, I've been already diagnosed with the HLA, the Q2 positive, but why should I do this in the blood? Be aware, and I'll leave it like that. Different story is this other stuff. This is a company out of Europe that's called Biodigene, and it's coming up with a very clever machine and one-stop business with 10 microliters. This is almost unbelievable. And one reaction, they extract, they run, and they give results within a minute that is quite remarkable, similar to what is the traditional way to do HLA typing. I mean, you just read, no, you read, the machine reads for you all the stuff, so if you're heterozygous, homozygous, and so on and so forth. So it can be also quantitative, it can give you the number of alleles of HLA, DQ2, DQ8. But where we're going, guys, and this is what I want to leave you with, where we're really going, diagnostic algorithms to avoid intestine biopsy. You need to appreciate intestine biopsy is still a struggle for families out there. And again, in a controlled, economically tight situation, if we can spare the $800 to do a biopsy, everybody would be happy, okay? But to do that, you need to have an algorithm that is close to perfection. The reason why is because you are telling the patient that for the rest of his or her life has to embrace a diet as a medical necessity. For people with celiac disease, the diet is like insulin for diabetics. It's not a trend. You got to be there for medical necessity, but you got to be absolutely sure. So, holy grail, avoid intestine biopsy. And I believe for a subgroup of people with celiac disease, we're getting there. I'll tell you in a moment. I told you, this is not fantasy anymore. We're approaching there. In our lab, we have already a couple of hits of biomarkers that will predict the onset of the autoimmune process in genetically predisposed celiac individuals before the disease goes there. If we will have these biomarkers identified, validated, we can revert this loss of tolerance before the damage is made and put these people in a tolerance mood in perpetuity. This is the holy grail of prevention. This is what we call customized, personalized medicine. You as laboratories would not do your job anymore the way that we've been using to do so far. You will not be just providers of a service. You will be integral part of healthcare. I, as a physician, in 10 years, will not be able to do my job if I don't work in concert, not as a server that I send you the specimen, you give me the result, but as integral part of processing, algorithm, decision making, if I don't have you and the people that do drug development around the same table. We are not all made equal. Celiac disease, diabetes, MS is the final destination. You can get there through different paths. Pretending the magic bullet that will fix them all, when we will find alternative treatment or cures for other autoimmune diseases, is not going to happen. Yesterday, I was telling you when at dinner, I learned during this process that the FDA considered a success, a clinical trial with efficacy, meaning that works, that cure or respond to what the drug is supposed to be doing, 35%. 35%. So if I develop a drug like Lipitor and I give to the people out there, I know already that 2 out of 3 would not respond. This is not sustainable. It's not sustainable because there is no way that we can pay this dear economical price knowing that the efficiency is so ridiculously low. The way to do it is stratification of the population. If I know that Lipitor acts on a specific pathway. And I have you guys help me to identify the pathway by finding the biomarkers so I can stratify the population. I will give Lipitor only the one that have the positive signal that will predict that this fellow will respond to Lipitor. The other two-thirds, they have to find another solution to control their cholesterol. And you appreciate that this is not just a passive, you know, feedback that you give to me. You got to be part of the game of stratification and their customized treatment. I didn't have the time. This would take an entirely different lecture about what is going on with this microbiome and host interaction. This is the most fascinating part of how I'm going to spend my rest of professional career before that I go play bocce. This is what is the holy grail of understanding really this interaction with the environment and really trying to understand what kind of pathways are activated when the wrong microbiome comes in our body and interplay with us. And pharmacometabolomics is pretty much what is the final destination when we really got all the pieces of the puzzle together. Is that really fantasy? Not at all, guys. Here is the example. This is a paper that was inconceivable until a few months ago that myself, a colleague of mine at the center, put out. We are the ones that said you have to have rigid, tough, you know, unflexible guidelines to make the diagnosis of celiac disease. We said to be diagnosed with celiac disease, you got to satisfy all five of this. You got to have sinus symptoms for celiac disease. The serology has to be positive. The HLA has to be compatible. The intestine biopsy needs to show the damage. And the symptoms, they need to go away when you go on a gluten-free diet. All five needs to be satisfied. And now clinical practice is showing us that it's fake, that it's not true. We have people that have celiac disease with no symptoms. I told you, under the line of water. Still, we call them celiac. There are 10, 15% of people that they are negative to biomarkers. Only 2%, but there are 2% the HLA negative. 15, 20% of the people that have truly celiac disease, they have no damage to look for when you do biopsy. If you leave them untreated, it's a question of time, they will develop it. By the time of the biopsy, they don't have it. And finally, there are people that you put on a gluten-free diet, and for months and months, they don't respond. Yet, they for sure, they have celiac disease. So we said, rather to satisfy all five, 4 out of 5 is enough. This will encompass all the permutation. Sure, not 80% will satisfy all five, but to capture the other 20%, you may have symptoms, you can have positive serology, positive meaning positive, not borderline. You can have the HLAs compatible, and your symptoms that go away when you're going to gluten-free diet, forget the intestine biopsy. You don't need that anymore. But that implies that you guys could do the job right, i.e. that you give me the right information here. So that's what I think that we're leading to. Now, again, I took all this time to give you a sense of where we were, where we are right now, and most importantly, where are we going? And this is a village that takes everybody to just work in concert together because really, the fun is still coming. Thank you so much.